So today I will just talk about a practical application of sequential optimization. But prior to that, I just want to introduce you to the kind of problems we are tackling in everyday business. I want to just expose one specific problem that I call dynamic impression pricing, and two solutions we came up with to solve this problem. And then we just really quickly did a comparison, empirical comparison between both methods, and so that we can assess them. So very very quickly, it's a very very quick introduction to the industry. So to simplify a lot, what is advertising? Digital advertising. It's basically a user visiting a website and an advertiser willing to display an ad to the user. So prior to 2008, the process of selling ad spaces, so blank spaces in web pages, was fully manual. Over the phone, people were calling advertiser and selling inventory. Now, since a couple of years, the whole process has been fully automatized. And now, when a user loads a web page, often, it doesn't concern all of the ads, but most of the ads are sold in real time. So it means that when the user opens the page, then during 100 milliseconds, there is an auction, and the advertiser can bid on the ad space that is displayed to the user, and the highest bidder gets the opportunity to display its ad. So it's a large chunk of display ads. So display ads are banners, classical banners, and it extends also to the video and other kinds of ads, but 30% of display ads are sold in real time in France, and it's half of the market in the US, and it's a very fast growing market and large market. So to maybe to summarize what are the different actors in this market, you have when a user is visiting a website, so every time you open the page, there is a request to a platform that is called an ad exchange. It is an automated platform to sell the ad space. And you have advertisers that are bidding on an ad space. I will go quickly on this one. Why was the process of selling ads automated? First, because the previous way of selling was really not efficient, and some spaces on pages were not worth paying someone to sell them over the phone. So the process of automation was started from this situation. Then, for different other technical reasons, it helped to add competition in the market to automate the selling process. And then the technology helped as well. So very good. So contrary to in this market, a lot of technology has been developed on the buy side. So advertisers, for example, like Criteo, are developing very sophisticated algorithm to display the right ad, the ad that will maximize clicks, for example, or conversions, or any kind of metric. Those kind of technology are very developed on the buy side. So you want to display the proper ad to the proper user. On the sell side, on the contrary, you have very little technology. RFD is working on the sell side. So RFD helps seller, so publisher websites, to sell to Criteo, for example, at the highest price possible, so that it has higher revenues. So very quickly, Alendi helps selling ads in real time. So on some platform, we take real time decision to set a price for each ad. We also help them pricing like packaged impression, like options or guaranteed volume or this kind of package. And then we help them making sense of all the data by crunching a large amount of data. So maybe to give you some order of magnitude of the amount of data we are dealing with, on a large French client or a medium-sized US client, we like a big news website, for example. You have more or less in the order of magnitude of 10,000 impressions each second, and each impression yields a report with the price of the auction. You have a lot of information about this auction, the identity of user, and all this. So we deal with very large amounts of data. So that you understand, so we note the impressions. An impression is a user visiting a web page and seeing one particular placement on the web page. So for example, the top of the page. Then you have advertisers that are people willing to buy this space to display an ad. And these advertisers, 1 to N, are bidding for each impression. So BI 1 is the bid of advertiser 1 on the impression I. Then the publisher can set what we call a reserve price. So the bid is the price the buyer over which the buyer is not willing to buy an ad. And on the sell side, the publisher, so the website, can set a price, a reserve price, under which he does not want to sell an ad. And here we put ourselves in a setting where the publisher can set a different reserve price for each buyer. So it can discriminate the price between buyers. So how the auction work? Basically, the highest bidder wins the auction. It's slightly more complicated. It's the highest bidder that is above its reserve price. So if the bid of a particular buyer is below the reserve price set for this buyer, then it is not eligible for the auction and it cannot win. And so the highest bid among eligible bids will win the auction. And another important point is that the de facto norm in the ad market, digital real-time bidding market, is the second price auction. So usually the buyer will get to pay the second highest price among the bids. Second highest price being the second highest bid or a reserve price, whichever is highest. So just to maybe give you an easier to understand sense of what's going on, I have a couple of pictures. So here's the whole process. It happens in 100 milliseconds, more or less. The user visits the web page. The seller sets a reserve price under which he's not willing to sell. Then the bidders are bidding like $10, $2. And the winner is the highest bidder and pays the second bid. What happens if the reserve price is higher, then the $2 bid is eliminated and the reserve price, which is $3 here, will act as a second price. So basically, compared to the previous situation, the selling price is higher because of the reserve price. So basically, we see here that the seller will have an impact on the price of the auction, of the impression, when it sets a higher reserve price. And of course, if you set a reserve price too high, then no bid is eligible, and then all the bids are discarded, and you don't sell your ad space, and you don't display any ad, or you display anything else.
Why do you choose a second price?
Oh, so there is a game theoretic reason for that, is that other kind of auctions, for example, first price auction, the buyer always has the incentive to bid less, because in a first price auction, you pay what you bid if you win. So if you say, oh, if I had a bid $1 less, I would have paid $1 less. So you always have an incentive to lower your bid. Whereas in a second price auction, you cannot have an impact on what you pay by lowering your bid. So it, under some hypothesis, it gives you the proper incentive that you bid your honest value for. So that's basically why the second price auction is the norm in the market.
The interest is not the same for the buyer and the seller.
The picture I have on top right represents the payoff of the buyer when it's bidding in the first price auction and second price auction. So you see that in second price auction, the only impact of lowering your bid is that at some point you will lose the auction. So you're not willing to. So the best strategy is to bid the highest price you are ready to pay, so that you maximize your chance of winning without altering the what you will pay. If the only thing that you will know is that you will never pay more than what you bid. Whereas in first price auction, and you can show that one Nash equilibrium is all the bid to zero, because everyone thinks the other will have the incentive to lower its bid, and so everyone bids zero, and the seller, of course, loses. Basically, you can see if you set the same reserve price for a lot of auctions. So here, you have to set a very low reserve price so that you don't lose any auction. If you higher your reserve price, then you will earn more on some auction and you will lose some other auctions. So this is what is going on today, because most of the sellers, they don't have any technology to set a reserve price more often than each week, for example. They can split their inventory and set different reserve price for different parts of inventory and all this, but basically they do all this manually. If you were able to set a different reserve price for each auction, then you could optimize the revenue of the website. So basically, that's the problem we want to solve, and there are a lot of instances of this problem. One instance is to solve this problem for every auction. That's what we do today on some platforms. So we have a real-time algorithm that in 10 milliseconds takes the decision of setting the price for an auction. Here, I want to talk about a more complicated instance, but that is less high frequency. On some platform, you only get to know data about the auction on an aggregate basis, and every hour, for example. So the instance I want to talk about here is an instance where you have period, hour, for example. The seller, at the end of every period, receives aggregate revenue data, and it can assign a reserve price for each buyer and tag for the next period, and so on. So at every period, it can observe aggregate revenue data linked to the reserve price he set previously. Basically, the seller wants to maximize the revenue of its website, and he wants to maximize the aggregate revenue of the website. It's a strong assumption, but I will not discuss a lot about this. We assume that the revenue it's a deterministic function of the reserve price plus some noise. At each step it's independently drawn from a Gaussian source. One of the approach we used first to solve this problem was to... before I go on, here you have a function to maximize. It's a very simple problem to state. And you set a vector as input, and you get a scalar result, which is your revenue. The problem is that evaluating this function costs you 1 hour of waiting. So you set a vector as input, 1 hour after you have the revenue that results. So it's costly function optimization, where you want to maximize in the least number of evaluation as you can. So the first approach we thought of was, okay, we'll evaluate at some point that I think is reasonable, and then I will trial and add perturbation to this point, and using, like for example, similar to simulated annealing method, see if I can improve at each step this state of things. So this is the first approach we tried with the Gaussian perturbations, and basically it was so this needs a point to start with, and hopefully. Usually the client we are talking to, they already have a setting, and we just have to optimize above this setting. So a good starting point is the actual setting that the client has today. And then we will, by perturbating and trying to optimize the revenue, we would increase and optimize the setting of the client. I mean, this is a very simple approach. And the problem with this approach is that most of the time you get stuck in local optima if you don't add enough noise at each step. And if you add too much noise, then it really gets very noisy, and you lose a lot of revenue because of trying very strange sets of reservoirs. So, and the other problem with this approach is that you don't accumulate a lot of information about the function you want to solve. So we would like to actually improve the representation of the function we are trying to maximize at each step. So the approach we want to evaluate is an approach where we assume that the function we want to maximize is drawn from a Gaussian process, and we want to update to do Bayesian updates at each step of our representation of function to maximize. So basically, here we assume that the function to maximize is Gaussian process, with F0 being the mean and K0 being the correlation structure of the process. At each step, I observe a new x, a new x, z, and a new value associated to z, and I want to update my knowledge about the distribution of a function. So it's a picture showing what's going on. We have a certain distribution of function a priori, with a correlation structure. So here we use the Gaussian kernel as a correlation structure, so it yields a very smooth trajectory. So you see that two points that are close by on the input set are very correlated, and after each observation we want to update our knowledge about the function to optimize. We use for our application isotropic Gaussian kernel for simplicity. And then the problem is, once you have this distribution a posteriori of a function, you want to know at which point you want to evaluate this function. So it looks like a bandit problem, where you have a continuum of possibilities with different expected values and different uncertainty. And so we applied the upper confidence bound heuristic. So basically, we maximize at each step the function, the mean from our functions function posterior plus kappa times the square root of the variance of our posterior. So basically, if our representation, if our distribution, for example, here the red dots are the evaluation, previous evaluation of the function, and the blue region represents the space, the distribution of the possible function we have after a couple of evaluation. Here, the upper confidence bound approach with different kappa yields to different assessment of the next point to evaluate at. So I have a couple of I have a couple of examples where we set different level of kappa. If kappa is small, I will tend to exploit. So here I have different steps of the algorithm. If kappa is small, I will tend to only exploit. So here I get stuck in the local optima. Basically, when the limit case of kappa going to zero is an optimization algorithm where you start with one measurement, then you randomize the direction in the space you want to explore, and then you follow the line of the two observations you have and find the optimum, and then you randomize on the overall space again, and then optimize on the plane, and so the limit case is a line search, an hyperplane search algorithm, and it gets often stuck in the local optima. The other extreme case is kappa very large. So when kappa is very large, then you tend to favor a lot exploration against exploitation, and you will just try to. So here are different iterations of the algorithm, and you will just go through the whole space and evaluate the function at as many points as you can. So with large kappa, the algorithm will just explore and never optimize anything. So of course there is a right kappa that starts by exploring, and after it has a good enough representation of the function, will start exploiting and find the global maximum hopefully. But the problem is then to tune the parameters. So basically, we applied this approach and compared to Metropolis Hastings approach on a simplified case of on a simplified set of functions. So here, basically, the function we optimize depends on the two floors, and it has several optima. And we run the first draft is so we run the optimization for 50 steps with Metropolis Hastings in a green and Gaussian process approach in a blue. And here is the distribution of the revenue of the fifth iteration, and for both, I just sort the result of the fifth iteration on the enough trial for Metropolis Hastings and Gaussian process approach. So if we look at the function, we see there are two local optima, one around that yields 1, and the other around 1.2. And here we see that in the first graph that the Gaussian process approach in half of the case finds ends up at the global optimum at the 50th step, whereas it's much more improbable for the Metropolis Hastings approach. The right graph is the sum of the revenue over the 50 steps, so which is the metric we want to optimize, and we see that Metropolis hosting yields in a lot of, I mean, the average. So here again, I ranked all the trials. So it's a distribution of the performance of both algorithms, and we see that the Gaussian process approach yielded better revenue over the 50 step of evaluating them. Here, of course, these results depend on the parameters of both approaches, and you have a lot of meta parameters in both approaches. So here we compare the two approaches with manually tuned the best parameters we can find for each approach. Of course, this has to be improved, and we are implementing it in production right now. So it will hopefully we will be able to have real life tests on the efficiency of such approaches. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nicolas, for this nice talk. Any questions? Yeah.
I'm sorry, I've lost something here, but I've always defined the time for closing the option at the beginning, because it's never closed, and if you have not time, time period for closing the option.
Oh, so the option is a simultaneous option. So every so there is a bid request sent to all the advertisers, and they have like 20 milliseconds to answer.
20 minutes.
Yeah. So, but I mean, they don't know the results of the other. So everyone is playing at the same time, and everyone discovers the results at the end without knowing anything about the others. It's not a sequential auction like you are used to in real life. It's not advertiser one saying, oh, I want $2, and the next one say, oh, no, I want $3. It's everyone, it's like like everyone playing the auction at the same time, and we discover the result, and then it's done. Yeah. Yeah, so, sorry, I couldn't enter too much in the detail of the auction. The important thing is that you can influence the revenue by setting a proper reserve price. As I said,
because people could indefinitely continue to propose new auctions, and
you're right.
Time interval, we cannot stop the auction.
Yeah, yeah. So the whole process ends in 100 milliseconds anyway, because you don't want to slow the process of displaying the content. But then the auction is simultaneous.
So suppose the bidders have a predefined process for the.
They have so they have policies, like usually they have algorithm that is based on the user identity and placement can give a price.